कर
हाँ यही है क्या?
वो नेहू ने इनवाइट किया होगा,
अच्छा
बस भी कंफ्यूज है।
हाँ
A very good afternoon to everyone. I, on behalf of Department of Geology, Nehu Silong, welcome you all today's lecture series on geology of northeastern India. As we all know that our country is celebrating Bharat Ka Amrit Mahotsav to commemorate 75 years of Indian's independence on 15 August 2022 in a befitting manner at national and international levels. As a run-up to this celebration, the Department of Geology, Northeastern Hill University, Shillong, in collaboration with the Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, has organized today's lecture series. Sitting atop the eastern margin of Indian plate, the Northeast India presents an ideal setting to understand the crustal evolution of the Northeastern region in terms of plate tectonics. We are privileged to have amidst us the eminent geologist who shall be sharing their expertise on various geological aspects of the region, including Eastern Himalaya. Without taking much time, I would like to request our respected...
Put it quickly.
Okay. Without taking much time, I would request our respected Professor Davis Walia, sir, Head of the Department of Geology, Nehu Silong, for the welcome address. Over to Sir Walia, please.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, organizing committee. I, on behalf of Northeastern Hill University, would like to welcome you all. I would like to state that our Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is presently the Pro Vice Chancellor, has got very important meeting, so for which he has to go to the High Court, wherein Chief Justice of the High Court is holding a meeting. So he has sent a message. So on his behalf and on my behalf, I would like to welcome you all for this very, very important celebration. So on his behalf, I would like to read his message. what he said, that he is very happy. Welcome you all on behalf of Northeastern Hill University. He would like to pay tribute on this very auspicious day to political and spiritual leader, Honorable Mahatma Gandhiji, who played very important role in the independence movement and moved the whole country with non-violence, satyagraha, and non-cooperation movement on 12th March 1930. Because of his contribution and because of contribution of many eminent political leaders and contributors for the freedom struggle, the freedom to India was achieved after almost 500 years of captivity, or 500 years of the rule by the other agencies. He also says that he is the one who said that there is a Triveni Sangam of Ganga, Yamuna and Saraswati, like at Allahabad. We need to build up with purity, with devotion to the country. We need to build up thinking that we are part and parcel of this country and we need to move on. He also put in the concept of Atmanirbhar Bharat in his own way, and he stressed, especially because of the salt satyagraha and against the clothes, having own cotton clothes against the European textile. And he said that we need to be self-dependent, and that's what was his basic principle, and because of which finally we could achieve this freedom struggle. Further, our Pro-Vice Chancellor Sir Professor Henry Lemon stated that to commemorate 75 years of independence, Indian independence, we will be organizing a lot of programs, including exhibitions, essay seminar, quizzes and all. So although these members, those who are present here or otherwise, they will be most welcome to participate in such programs. I, as Professor Devesh Walia, Head Department of Geology, would like to thank Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, to have very aggressively contributed towards organizing this program. So we would like to thank. And we know that the Prime Minister of India has listed 5 pillars to commemorate 75 years of independence, Indian independence, which are freedom, ideas, action, achievement, and resolve. Each word requires our great thought, and each word is supposed to be taken up, built up into whole philosophy to take India forward. So with these few words, I would like to thank organizers, thank everyone to have taken out time to participate in such a program. Thank you, Meghali.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now I would like to request Dr. J. Rajeshwar, Deputy Director General and HOD Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, for the inaugural address. Over to Sir Rajeshwar, please.
Has he joined? You can just check.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon to all. Respected Vice Chancellor, Professor Lamin, Professor Devesh Walia, Department of Geology, and distinguished speakers, and all participants. I welcome you all to this program being held under the banner of Bharat Ka Amrut Mahotsava. being organized by the Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, Shillong, in collaboration with the Geological Department of Nehu, Northeastern Hill University, Shillong. We are celebrating the 75th year of independence. Definitely, this has been a glorious journey for the entire country to reach this milestone. As a part of the celebration of the 75th anniversary of independence, different organizations, departments of the Government of India are arranging programs to showcase of achievements in their respective fields towards the nation. Geological Survey of India is a premier organization in the field of geosciences, is also actively participating in the celebration of Bharat Ka Amrut Mahotsava. Geological Survey of India was established in the year 1851 for the purpose of the exploration coal prospects in India. It is the second oldest survey department, was established in India under the leadership of Dr. Thomas Oldham. Today, Geological Survey of India is an attached office to the Ministry of Mines, Government of India, and Geological Survey of India has functions all the state units, offices in the country, with the central headquarters situated at Kolkata. During the 117 years of Geological Survey of India's history, starting with exploring coal, the department has diversified a lot, bearing the exploration of radioactive elements and petroleum. Our department is actively involved in every aspect of geosciences. The Geological Survey of India has made a world-class mineral discoveries in India, and we have completed geologically mapping the entire country on 1:50,000 scale. This in itself is a remarkable achievement which only very few other countries in the world could achieve. Geological Survey of India has and is actively contributing in various fields of geosciences, from mineral exploration to geological hazards, monitoring and mitigation measures. In fact, as I speak to you now, several of our geoscientists are presently engaged in post disaster assessment of yesterday's earthquake that shocked the northeastern parts of the country. Geological Survey of India is also involved in different geological research programs to better understand the geological factors which are responsible for shaping this earth. This in turn leads to understanding of our different factors which affect our lives, either in the form of landslide, flooding, earthquake, etc. I hope these lectures will help the budding geologist and students to understand different aspects of the geology of northeastern India, particularly the eastern Himalayas. I request all the participants to feel free to actively interact with the speakers for understanding the aspects of Himalayan geology. I also request all the speakers from Geological Survey of India and guests to make this session an interactive one and to make this effort with a good, fruitful event. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Now I would like to request Sri J.K. Naik, Director PSS Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, for delivering the speech on the theme of the today's lecture series. Over to Sir Nayak, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. My respects to Professor Provisi, Professor Lamin, our head of the department, GSI NER, Dr. J. Rajeswar, respected Professor Deveswalia, head of the Department of Geology, NEHU. It's a nice experience that we are starting, basically, as per the Government of India directives, 75 weeks are to be celebrated. And that is a pride for us to celebrate in all over India by GSI. So in that effort, this is we are beginning with our celebration of the 75 years of independence as far as GSI Northeastern region is concerned. I thank you, Dr. Professor Walia, for giving us this opportunity to interact in the form of sharing our knowledge of our eminent workers in this particular field of Eastern Himalayas. Thank you for sharing your thoughts that these topics have been carved out and we have identified the geoscientists who have long experience in delivering the lecture. In the beginning, I would like to introduce Dr. Debohati Mukherjee. It's a great privilege for me to introduce Dr. Debohati Mukherjee, who will be delivering the a lecture on the fossils and its importance, particularly in Eastern Himalayas, who has a vast experience in the field of paleontology and earned a name in a national as well as international forum, particularly as an expert of brachiopods. She had done extensive research on fossils of Eastern Himalayas, and with that experience, she will be, her experience will definitely benefit one and all who is participating in these sessions. After that, Dr. K.V. Thenew, he will be delivering lectures on the economic importance, economic minerals of Eastern Himalayas and the rocks. Dr. Thenew, after completing his MSc from Bangalore University, he has completed his PhD from IIT Banaras Hindu University under the able supervision of Professor S.B. Dwivedi in the field of metamorphic petrology. Since joining GSI in the year 2012, he has been continuously working in Eastern Himalayas, may it be the ophiolite complexes of Manipur and Nagaland and the associated metamorphics, or the volcanics in and around the syntaxial blend in the form of lychee and ever volcanics. So it can be understood his vast experience in particularly in working in Eastern Himalayas. Lastly, Sri Ramesh Laisram. I'd like to introduce him in these terms that Sri Laisram, after completing his MSc from Punjab University, Chandigarh, had done extensive research work in the higher Himalayan crystalline and the geochronological aspects of Eastern Himalayas under the supervision of Professor Sandeep Singh from IIT Roorkee. He joined GSI in the year 2010 and initially worked in the Northwestern Himalayas in different parts of Himachal Pradesh, taking expeditions. Subsequently, after joining NER Shillong on transfer, he has been associated mostly in the research work of aneurysm in the syntaxial band and also as a part of the disaster studies like landslide disaster. These three speakers will be sharing their experiences in the topics as outlined in the detailed schedule program. Without taking any much time, I request to conduct the further proceedings. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir, for your admiring speech. Now we switch over to technical session. Now I would like to request Dr. K.V. Thenew, Senior Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, for delivering the lecture on lithology of the Eastern Himalaya and Eastern Syntaxial Zone, highlighting the rock types of the region with special emphasis on the economic mineral potential. Over to Sir Thenew, please.
You can share your presentation if you have.
Yeah,
I'll take a minute to open my presentation. Kindly bear with me. Is my visible, sir?
Yes, it is.
Thank you, Madam. Respected Vice Chancellor and Professor Divesh Walia, Head of the Geology Department, respected the DYDG and HOD, JSINER Shillong, and Director PSS, and all the distinguished guests present this afternoon. It's really a privilege for me to share this presentation on the topic of geology of Eastern Himalaya and the mineralization potential associated with it. On the commemoration of 75 years of Indian independence, as per the program, we will be delivering these three lectures. And the first lecture will basically deal with the lithology of Eastern Himalaya and Eastern syntaxial zone, the highlighting the rock types of the region with special emphasis on the economic mineral potential. As we all know, northeastern part of India is undoubtedly one of the most challenging terrain in the Himalayan range. And although there are lots of extensive work that has been carried out in the eastern part of the Himalayan range, however, when it comes to the Eastern Himalayan range in Arunachal Pradesh, there are yet lots of work to be carried out. GSI, one of the premier institution and organization in working related to mapping and mineral exploration, is one of the most earlier workers that has worked on this Eastern Himalayan syntaxis. This afternoon, I'll be dealing mostly with the basic geology of the Eastern Himalaya and the mineral potentials of the area. Here in the screen, we are seeing the outline of the Eastern Himalayan syntaxis. If you see here, we have the Tibetan Himalaya, which occupies the highest elevation of the topography in Eastern Arunachal Pradesh, with most of the elevation above 6,000 meters. We have number two, then the higher Himalayan sequence, which is bounded by the famous well-known structural discontinuity of MCT on the southern part, and followed by the lesser Himalayas and the sub-Himalayas. The numbers are given here in the screen. Then we have the Trans-Himalayas that is located on the Dibang and Lohit district on the eastern part of the syntaxis. And then we come to the Nagapatkai ranges that but with the Mishmi thrust. And then finally, the number seven, we have the Brahmaputra plain. So this is in general the classification of Eastern Himalayan sequence in Arunachal Pradesh. As we all know, there are lots of names from formations and specific succession that have been given for different little units. However, in order to avoid any confusion, I won't be dealing strictly with the name of the formation, but
However, this is the geological map of Arunachal Pradesh and the lithostratigraphic classification as per the GSI MISPAP 2010. We can see that most of the older rocks that we found here from Proterozoic to the Quaternary and the recent alluviums, all the rocks are exposed with the older sequence thrusted above one another on the higher elevation. And as we come to the lower elevation, we can see that the younger formations and groups are exposed. We will be discussing in detail the different little units. As I have already mentioned, the geographical distribution of the Eastern Himalayan syntaxis. However, in order to have a clear and basic understanding of the lithology of Eastern Himalaya, we will be dealing with the stratigraphic sequence, mostly with the geological age, having from Proterozoic, then we have the Paleozoic, and then the Paleogene, and the Quaternary, and the recent alluviums. So this is the generalized stratigraphy unique of GSI classification after 2010 MISPAP. You can see here the little units, the geological age, the formation, name of the formation, and the group name. However, we won't be restricting to the name of the formation, and our main observation and discussion will be on the little units. I will just brush up, because of this time constraint, I'll just brush up on the different types of little units that we come from the older sequence to the younger sequence. First, the Proterozoic. This is a pictures view or a panoramic view of Manchukuo, which we can see on the northern part of the photograph. These are all of the higher Himalayan sequence and the Tibetan Himalayans, equivalent of Tibetan Himalayans sequence. These are the higher Himalayan sequence, which GSI took out some petrological studies and geological mapping and aerial photography FSP field season programs that have been carried out. As mentioned earlier, that you can see from the field photographs of the outcrops and the terrains, the challenges that are involved in mapping and taking out, collecting samples, structural data, and exploration purposes, the challenges that is encountered doing certain geological mapping assignments. These are the outcrop of the Proterozoic, what we often known as the Sela group, or the older formation of the Proterozoic. This is how the outcrop looks. The high-grade metaphyllites, they are the little units are basically of the high-grade metaphyllites and migmatites. You can see the different migmatites and outcrop exposures, the garnet deforest metaphyllites, and partial melting features. These are the basic little units of high-grade metaphyllites, which metamorphose up to upper amphibolite and granulite facies rocks. Then we have the Bomdila group, mainly composed of orthognathous and other volcanic sequence within the lesser Himalayan and the higher Himalayan sequence, are mainly of the lesser Himalayan, part of the lesser Himalayas, and they are composed the dominant little units. We also have other calcareous rocks such as marble, limestone, and other carbonate rocks associated with it. This is a part of the higher Himalayan crystalline again. Metasematic rocks with layering. These are the high-grade rocks of the higher Himalayan crystallines, part of Tato and Manchukuo Manigong section. This are how the rock look. These are quartzites and metasematic rocks, garnetiferous in composition, garnetiferous and metasematic to semi-palytic in composition, which are metamorphosed to upper amphibolite to granulite facies rocks. This is the typical little unit of garnet schist, garnetiferous schist. We have sillimanite schist, sillimanite garnet, garnetite, sillimanite schist, and within the thrust zone, along the thrust zone, you can also find that graphite schist, carbon-rich graphite schist, and rocks are highly schistosed and foliated and sheared along the thrust contacts. These are some of the rock types, rock of large granite porphyroblasts with cordierite, which are of granulite faces, biotite rich ground mass, and we can see local partial melting associated with it. Just to show that thin sections of the minerals that we can find, you can see very well preserved tectonic features, internal schistosity as well as external schistosity, from which we can identify the different phases of deformation and metamorphism. So it provides a very good opportunity for study the structures and metamorphism associated with it. The different little units are also formations also differentiated by unconformities. These are the conglomerates. Unconformity along the unconformity, we find some conglomerates bed. Coming to the paleolithic, which mostly composed of the gondwanas and the quartzites, Devonian quartzite. We have the Miri quartzite and the Silicorum quartzite and the Bolin quartzite. These are intruded by the Abhor volcanics, which are which you can see here. Different names are given: Miri quartzite, Silicorum quartzite, and Bolin quartzite. Different characteristic and even sedimentary structures, structural features are often preserved. The Gondwanas, we have the coal balls, the diamictites, part of the lower Gondwanas, and the exposures, and different clasts of carbonate clasts and quartz, quartzite clasts, quartzite clasts, even volcanic clasts, which are can be seen as dropstones within the diamictites. Coming to the volcanics, volcanics, they are based on the field relationship. They are basically classified into two, as Litchi volcanics and Upper volcanics. Although we won't be going into detail, this is are the field features, and these are part of the associated with the intrusive into the as seals and dikes within the Silicorum quartzite and Bolin quartzites. There are different varieties of lithoinits where we can see the rhyolites, the pyroclastics, and the amygdular basalts. These are the basic dominant lithotypes of the Abhor volcanics, which you can see the pyroclastic deposits and the amygdular basalts under petrographic studies, how it looks, the porphyritic textures, the plagioclase, quartz giving the porphyritic textures. Then we have the siwaliks, current bed sandstone upstream of Papum River. This is Bansiri formation, and drop stones and planar cross beddings and lenzoidal body of coal observed in Subansiri. These are the features and structures preserved in the siwaliks. Coming to the Trans-Himalayan part, we can see that we have done some traverses along the Mayodhya Tiding Lohit area. And these are the part of ophiolite, garnet bearing amphibolite. These are part of the soil metamorphics associated with the ophiolite, Mayodhya ophiolite. Coming to the mineral resources, I will just highlight some of the few points. GSI workers has early GSI workers during the geotechnical investigation from 1950s, they were the first to report occurrence of sulfide mineralizations in Ranga Valley and limestone. Post-independence, GSI has carried out some project works, along which certain mineralization zone has been reported. In 1960, Assam Circle, GSI located few occurrences of limestone and graphite of Lower Subansiri, West Siang, and Lohit district. And regarding the base metal mineralization, Precambrian crystallines from Precambrian crystalline rocks, base metals like tin and tungsten mineralization were also reported. And although the geosynchronous clastic considering the tertiary mountain belt of Naga Lushai and Patkai, They have the potential for oil and natural gas and coal along the shelf fringe. Occurrence of limestone, dolomite, base metals, etc. have been recorded from Paleozoic of rocks of Arunachal Pradesh, including hydroelectric projects, minerals and fossil fuel potential has also been carried out for exploration purpose. And other minerals, including clay, beryl, base metals, and cobalt, indication of cobalt and pyrites, and nickel in pyrrhotite has been, such metals has been reported by GSI. Besides that, although these are non-metallic minerals, investigation of locating limestone marble was undertaken by GSI and along the Tidding and discovery of Tidding limestone and Dora marble deposits in Lohit district has been reported. And the coal deposits of Nampuk in Tirap district, these are tertiary coals investigated by GSI and proved a reserve of 17 million tons with the help of drilling, and about 100 million tons in the indicated category was established. These are the field features of how sulfide mineralization along certain structural discontinuities, shear zones, and thrust are manifested. This is in brief the stratigraphy of tertiary coals in Northeast India, as you can see. For those of you who are more interested, you can refer to GSI miscellaneous publication of 2010. This is another table of the lithostratigraphic sequence of coal seam and the analysis coal quality parameters of Karsing coal field in Changlang district of Arunachal Pradesh. Another chemical analysis of thickness and seam wise of the Namchik Nampuk area. This is one of the most maximum reserve of coal in Arunachal Pradesh, and it is estimated of 17.10 million tons. Besides coal, we also have arsenopyrites, and which are reported from have recorded up to 23.37% arsenic, 10.13 sulfur and 100 ppm cobalt and 50 ppm nickel. Such values are also reported from lower Subansiri district within a 1 meter thick quartzite and quartz vein. Base metals includes the lead and zinc mineralization, mainly represented by presence of galena and sphalerite, which are found in associated with the dolomite bands in the form of disseminations and stringers. Average lead zinc content is less than 1.5%. Although right now there is not much encouragement, but these percentages are reported from such a rock type. Pyrrhotite mineralization in mica schist with the dolomite and host rock quartzite is associated with carbonaceous phyllite. The nicest and low grade metasedimentary scary base metal sulfides represented by pyrrhotite, pyrite, chalcopyrite, bornite, and galena. Polymetallic sulfide mineralization represented by pyrite, pyrrhotite, chalcopyrite with minor sphalerite and galena associated with nickel, cobalt, tin, and tungsten extends for a strike length of 3 kilometers with a width of up to 100 meters, occurs in the green schist to lower amphibolite regis rocks of Katavari formation of the Bomdila group. Gold panning has been recorded from Subansiri River during old Ahom Kingdom time also, and the rocks of Upper Siwaliks have shown presence of gold in form of fine dust, minute grains, and fine flakes. The values of 50 ppb values are reported, and as I said, 2.67 ppm, and in terrace samples, the gold value recorded is less than 50 ppb. Iron. The GSI is also carrying out some projects, exploration projects, native gold exploration, as well as other gold exploration projects are currently undertaken. Coming to iron, occurrence of boulders of micaceous hematite on a small ridge of the flank of Bichon River is recorded within the quartzite. And then platinoids. As I mentioned earlier, the Tiddings and Myodia ophiolite, the ultramafic bodies associated with it, including the parametamorphites in Myodia area, have been investigated. And on 10 samples collected from the area, recorded a PT value ranging from less than 5 ppb to 50 ppb. and palladium value less than 10 ppb. These are some values that have been reported. And asbestos, besides that, there are some other minerals, asbestos in serpentinite, beryl in pegmatite veins, limestone, dolomite, marble, glass, sand, graphite, talc, and rock phosphate. These are some of the economic minerals. These are found in Arunachal Pradesh. Besides this minerals exploration that has been reported by GSI, even at present, there are lots of exploration on vanadium rich graphite schist. These are explorations are extensive explorations are being carried out by GSI in Arunachal Pradesh. Yeah, so far that is the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. K.V. Theuno, for giving elaborate overview of Arunachal Pradesh, especially the northeast part of India. Organizer Meghali, you can just take over. Dear friends, you have got the overview of lithology of this region, which is, we can understand that, which is one of the very, very important regions in the northeastern part also, because it has got great potential. And second thing is, it is still not yet fully worked out. So there is a lot of potential is there. So it falls definitely with the theme that we are commemorating 75 years of independence. At the same time, we know that where potential lies. So that's what it is, very, very important. Thank you. Yeah, Meghali, please.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to request Sri Ramesh Laisaram, Senior Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeast.
We'll not have discussion on his lecture. You won't allow anybody to ask any query if they have.
Okay.
I think okay, that will be, because he is available, otherwise he also may be free after such a discussion. So
okay.
It will be that if anybody has got any question, although in the chat box there is no any query as such. But otherwise, if anybody wants to interact, give chance.
Okay. Now it's time for discussion.
Yeah. So, dear friends, you are free to ask any specific query or anything, whatever you feel like, especially with reference to lithology and economic mineral potential of Arunachal Pradesh. So you are most welcome. Anybody wants to ask anything can raise the hand and can ask the question. You can unmute
Hello?
Yourself and then ask the question, please. Yes. If you
Hello,
want,
sir,
you can
you
write
hear
it
me?
In the chat box also. If your connection is not that good, you can write in the chat box. Then we can place your question for discussion.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Sir, I'm a BSc geology student from Rajiv Gandhi University.
All right.
Myself Lemne Wang now. So right now, our ma'am sent me this link to join this group. So we are working on the project work for final semester. So
please.
Yeah. Hello? One, he's asking, please. Others, you can mute for the time being. Yeah, please.
Yeah. So, sir, I find very interesting this. So, can I get some PPT for my project work as I'm lack of resources?
Most of this these data on behalf of.
Your voice is not clear.
Yeah, it's all right. Most of the data is available through the GSI publications or even on the net.
Yes.
So. Dr. K.V. Theuno, actually he wanted to get a PowerPoint presentation or PDF presentation of your PDF presentation. So if you can post it on this place, it may be okay. Otherwise, most of the things are already published. So it is, I think he is getting disconnected time and again. Yeah.
Okay, sir. I'm preferring this. Gopendra Gupta, I found one book in our library, but I found that all the materials are from, sir, it's kind of outdated. All are very old information are here.
Yeah, so I'll take your this query or your this request to ask for this to him. So okay. He got disconnected.
Okay, sir. So where I can download any kind of...
He referred to one publication. That publication, he referred GSI miscellaneous publication of 2010. So yes, from sir. There only most of the things are there, but yeah, he's there online again. Okay, yeah, Dr. Maybe, no, again, he's getting disconnected.
Oh, maybe some...
Perfect, thank you. If any other question is there, you are most welcome.
Sir, there are some questions in the chat box as well.
Yeah, chat box I'll take care. Yeah, anybody else wants to ask anything?
Hello.
Yeah, please.
I'm not able to hear, but
The moment your connection is stable, I'll put all those things to you. Don't worry. Your connection is not very stable. Is it okay now? You are able to hear? Yeah, madam, you can ask.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, and thank you for this nice presentation. I would like to ask, sir, about that mineral resources, specifically about the arsenopyrite, which he has mentioned there.
Yeah.
So I want to know that arsenopyrite is very, means can observe under the microscope only, or whether it is very visible in the hand specimen. Hello. Did you get my question, sir?
Can I ask actually? Oh, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am. He wrote down your question and he will ask the question to Dr. Theono as soon as he's able to connect.
Breaking. Okay.
Madam, we are not able to get him. We'll put this question about arsenopyrite to him the moment he is connected.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, Dr. KVP, are you there? Your connection is stable now? No. You can, if anybody has got any further question, you are most welcome. Dr. KV, is your connection okay now? You can hear me? No, I don't think he's able to hear. Dr. KV, you know,
yes.
Are you able to hear me?
Not hearing.
Yes,
hello. Yeah, yes, madam, you can say.
Yeah, I asked a question about arsenopyrite.
Yeah.
So
I'll ask him on your behalf. Whenever he's available, I'll ask him.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, anybody else has got any query? Anybody else has got any question? Yeah, doctor. Yeah, I think we'll move ahead because he's facing some problem. So, maybe you can move ahead and unshare his presentation because of that, the screen has gone blank. You tell them to unshare. Share anybody else something different, then he'll be unshared automatically.
Okay. Now I would like to request Sri Ramesh Laisera, Senior Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, for delivering the lecture on structure and tectonics of the Eastern Himalaya and Eastern Syntaxial Zone with special emphasis on the hazards or disasters. Over to Sir Laisaram, please.
I think they are all together. Just wait, dear friends, we are finding some problem. Hence, we are not able to connect them. This is our state of affairs, not only in northeastern part of India, but rest of India too. So just wait, let me call.
Hello, sir.
I can see the so Lakshman sir is here.
Yeah. So you have been invited to deliver the lecture, Mr. Ramesh Lakshman. So you can share your presentation and you can start, please. Are you able to hear? Yeah. Yes.
Ashram sir, please unmute yourself. You are still muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, clear.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all the friends. DDZ and HOD is GSINER. Professor Devis Walia, Head of Department, Geology Department, Nehu, and all my friends. As a continuation of the previous lecture, I'll be talking about the structure and tectonics of the Eastern Himalaya, touching a little bit on the Eastern Syntaxial Zone, and after that I'll be talking a little bit on the hazard and disaster. Talking about hazard, disaster, and tectonics, all these related feature, we can still remember yesterday's earthquake that struck. That struck Assam yesterday, which was very unfortunate. We have some loss in property there. So keeping that in mind, let's go a little backward and the past. Let's start with Gondwana land breakup, which happened at late Jurassic time when India drifted apart from all its neighboring continents. All his neighboring continents. and then India started its northward movement at the late Jurassic and crossing the Tethys Ocean and leaving behind the present day Indian Ocean in its backside. As it journeyed towards, as India journeyed from the southern hemisphere towards the Eurasian plate, India at around say 65 million years, India crossed reunion hotspot, which led to the eruption of the fissure eruption and then deposition of the Deccan tribe in the Indian subcontinent. And at the same time, at around 65 million years, the head of the Tethys Ocean started subducting below the Eurasian plate. Which led to the formation of the island arc in the form of the Kohistan and the Ladakh batholith in the west. And then in the eastern part, we have the Lahit batholith as an island arc. Then as it further moved forwards, then the India and the Eurasian plate, actually the plate, the continental plate actually collided, at around 45 million years in the time of Eocene, and then the present day Himalaya come into existence and in the time of Miocene at say around 20 million years. Then this is the present simplified geological Himalayan belt is 2,500 kilometer long, starting from the northwestern syntaxial band of the Nanga Parbat and up to the northeastern syntaxial band at this Namcha Barwa. And typically the Himalayan belt is divided into the Shivaliks, the Lesser Himalaya, the Greater Himalaya, the Deccan Himalaya, and then after the sutures on the Trans-Himalaya. Trans-Himalaya will be the part of the Eurasian continent. So basically these subdivisions are subdivided by major discontinuities, the Himalayan frontal fault, the main boundary thrust, the main central thrust, the South Tibetan detachment system, and the Indo-Tibetan suture zone, ITSZ.
So this is generally about coming from the Gondwana to the formation of the Himalaya. Then we'll be coming the cross-section. Let's have a brief view of the cross-section of the Himalaya as a whole before going to Arunachal Himalaya. So in the process of this movement, in Indian plate movement from the southern hemisphere to the northern, and then ultimately the collision with the Eurasian plate formation. And during this time when the Indian plate was moving, I'd say at around 55 to 30 million years, the trans-Himalayan batholiths were formed. Then around 55 at the same time, the Indian Indo-Tsangpo Sutral Zone were also formed, and these are represented by politic volcanic rock, high pressure magmatic rocks. And then at around 45 to 35 million years, the Tethian Himalayan came into existence. This is represented by the Himalayan sedimentary sequence, which are interfingered with the Ophiolithic melanges. Then at around 24 to 17 million years, the higher Himalayans came into existence after the main central thrust activation. Then lesser Himalaya come into existence at around 11 to 17 million years, and they have the sediments from Proterozoic to Cambrian, and then metamorphosed sedimentary rock, quartzite marble, as well as some granitic rock. And then at around 2.62 recent, the sub-Himalayan Siwalik belt come into existence, and then we have the Indo-Gangetic plains and Brahmaputra plain in the eastern part of our country. So this is a generalized cross section of the Himalaya as a whole. Then coming to Arunachal Pradesh, Dr. Tenu has already described the lithology, various lithologies that are exposed in the Arunachal Himalayas. I'll be talking about the structures, taking into a particular traverse in concern, like say from Bhalukpong to Tawang. It was a project for Geological Survey of India to prepare a guidebook in the International Geological Congress, which ultimately got postponed. Coming to that, this is the geological traverse map from Bhalukpong to Tawang. Geologically, we have full exposure from the Siwalik up to the Sela group of rock. Though the Tethian Himalayan sequence, people believe that it is in Arunachal Pradesh, but so far mapping of the Tethian Himalayan sequence in Arunachal Pradesh has not been done. And up to the latest knowledge possible in Geological Survey of India, we have not done any mapping in the Tethian Himalayan sequence. So I'll be concentrating only up to the Sela group of rocks. So starting from the south to north, we have the Siwaliks, then the Gondwanas, then the Bomdilas, then the Sela group of rocks. So this is the traverse move. I'll be going point-wise from point to point. In the first point, number one, that is in Bhalukpong, we have the Himalayan frontal thrust. The Himalayan frontal thrust is displayed in the form of an antithetic fault here near Prasanthi Cottage, and we can appreciate the angular unconformity between the Siwaliks and the quaternary sediments. And then, though this is not exactly from this Bhalukpong section, this is from Dambuk area in Dibang Valley. Here we can appreciate the Himalayan frontal thrust, where the quaternary sediments is being overridden by the shales and quartz cores out of the Siwaliks. Then further going north, we come to the this Tipi thrust. Tipi thrust is exposed in a place called Tipi, after a little bit ahead of Bhalukpong, and here the Dafla formation, that is the middle Siwalik, is the Dafla formation, that is the upper lower Siwalik, is overriding the Subansiri formation, that is the middle Siwalik. Then this overriding thrusting activity can also be witnessed even in the petrography also, where we can see the kink bands being developed within the shale layers in the Dafla sequences. Then further going north, we come at the Pinjoli Nala, where the main boundary fault is exposed, where the Gondwana group of rocks are overriding the Siwalik group of rocks. These can be seen in the field evidence in the form of the shelly layers of the Gondwana in the southwards versions, so in the southwards versions, even in the this in the Dafla sandstone also we can see sigmoids, and we can see the sigmoids being forming within the lithology and their southward versions also. And then further coming north, as we come near Dirang, we have the exposure of the Man Central Trust, where the quartzites of the Dirang formation is being overridden by the schist of the Sela group of rock. And in the petrography, we can see the snowball effect, means the rotation of the rotation within the rotated foliation within the garnets in the schist of the Sela group of rocks. Then a very interesting feature of these Himalaya, particularly starting from the upper lesser Himalaya to the higher Himalaya, is that they show inverted metamorphism. So basically in metamorphism, as we gain height, means as we go topographically higher, the greater metamorphism should have decreased. But in the Himalaya, as we go topographically higher, the greater metamorphism keeps on increasing. Say the Barobian zone, say from fluorite, it will increase to biotite, garnet, then we'll go to kyanite, selenite, k-feldspar, like that. But that is the Barobian, that sequence is also found in this Himalaya, but as we go up higher instead of going lower. So there are different different models to explain these metamorphic exhumation and inverted metamorphism. Some of them is like say a hot plate movement, then the frictional heat that is generated because of the uplifting of the higher Himalaya along the MCT, and there is the deformation of isograde, means the geothermal gradient is being deformed along with the geothermal gradient is being brought up along with the MCT, and then because of the erosion, because of the erosion of the overlying layers, the high grade of rock are being exposed at the upper portion. Then in the extrusion of wedges, in the form of wedges, it has come up. And then in third is the channel flow. This is the recent model where they try to explain the inverted metamorphism because of these movement of the upper crust between the MCT and STD, and because of the effect of the erosion. So this is another example where we can see another generalized cross section of the Himalaya, where we can see at the lesser Himalayan sequence, we have the biotite, and as we come across to the MCT, we have the garnets, torolite, kyanite, then we have the selenite. Grade of rock means it keeps on increasing, the metamorphic grade keeps on increasing as we gain height, as we go upward to the higher Himalayan crystalline. This has been explained on the basis of this partial melt in this MCT zone, and then the isograde has been also been brought up. Isograde, that is the temperature geothermal gradient, has also been brought up with along the MCT. Then this inverted metamorphism is also well exposed in our Bhalupong to Tawang section, and starting with around say the Munna camp, we have the first appearance of the garnet, which indicates our start of the garnet zone. Then this is within the contact between the Bomdilanais and the garnet bearing cysts of the Dirang formation. Then at around Rama camp, we have the appearance of the kyanite for the first time in this section. Then I'm going further north, in this rod section. So we can appreciate the increase in the grade with the first appearance of this mineral. And near Sapar, this group of rock is intruded by the tertiary granite, tourmaline bearing leucogranites, which has been dated to around 29 million years by Bhalla et al. In 1991. Then as we go further north at around Yaswangar, we have the first appearance of selenite, and then this section. So we have seen in this section, we have seen the garnet and the muscovite and the selenite. So This is up to the section that we have prepared, so I'll not be going further. So this is a little bit about the tectonics and then about the inverted metamorphism in the Arunachal Himalaya. Then coming back to our second part of this lecture, Eastern Himalayan syntaxis. The Eastern Himalayan syntaxis, as I already told, the 2,500 kilometer long Himalayan range is extending from the northwestern Nanga Parbat to the Namcha Barwa peak and not a eastern part of India, not exactly not Namcha Barwa is not in India, it's in Tibet. And the Indian part of these is exposed in the form of the Siang and from here. But this Namcha Barwa peak, this in eastern syntaxis, is a place of most intensive deformation, and it has two series of structures. There is the earlier ductile contraction and the lateral slip associated with the Indian Asia collision, and the later ductile brittle fold formed by the collapse structure caused by rapid uplift in the later time of 7.3 to 6.3 mm. And then this zone is strongly witnessed by strong subduction and shortening, thickening of the crust, the hyperacid granuli, inversion of densities, delamination, and then rebound and uplift of the eastern Himalayan syntaxis. This eastern Himalayan syntaxis is preserved in the form of the Xiang endiform in the Indian part, where the east-west trending, the east-west trending Himalayan belt is turning, is taking a turn to northwest, south-southeast trend here. It is represented by the Cenozoic metasediments of the Miri, the Yingkwang, and the Abhor volcanics. And the lithology has already been described by Dr. Thenu, and the Yingkwang group is mainly basically composed of saphelite, schist, and limestone. The Miri is mainly dominated by quartzite and dolomite, and the Abhor is basically basalts and other volcanics. And then, coming to the third part of our lecture, disaster. Disaster is nothing. It's an accident or a natural catastrophe that causes great damage or loss of life. And then the natural hazard is a natural phenomena that occur in nature and have a negative impact on life and other animals of the environment. So example to understand this is that, for example, yesterday we noted an earthquake happened in Assam. That earthquake is a hazard. Hazard, but when it is associated with the loss of life and property, it becomes a disaster. So taking into account some major earthquake in the northeast, we have the Kasar earthquake of 1869, then the Silong Assam earthquake of 1897, and the Sri Mangal earthquake of 1918, Dhubri earthquake of 1930, and Assam earthquake of 1950. Of which the Silong Assam earthquake of 8.7 is the highest magnitude. The same also can be appreciated in this map where the epicenter has been located in a SRTMDA map. Then, so in order to say we cannot exactly predict when an earthquake may occur, but we can have preparedness. So for preparedness, Geological Survey of India take up seismic hazard zonations projects in various cities of the northeastern state. One of example is the seismic hazard map of this Itanagar has been generated. Here we can, after this map, in this map we can see that this red part is the most vulnerable, where the peak ground acceleration will be generated during an earthquake. So if you already have a map like this with the district authorities, can take a precautionary measure accordingly. So such type of work is being taken up in the Geological Survey of India. Then some of the tectonic activities that neotectonic activities, like say in the Himalayan frontal trend, where the quaternary is being overridden by the crust quartzite of the Sivaliks, and then here also another quaternary fault along the river bank of the Ipipani River in the Dibang Valley. And new tectonic evidences can also be seen in these same in the form of sandbag in the between the quaternaries. This is in Assam and Arunachal border around say Silopathar, and these are also indicative of the active tectonics. Active tectonics means because of the recently induced earthquake or recently happened disasters. Then another main natural hazard that occurs in Arunachal Pradesh and that rest of the hilly terrain of the northeastern region is the landslide, which oftentimes causes loss in property as well as loss in life. Is the landslide, and Geological Survey of India takes up many type of landslide program, like the macro scale, the National Landslide Susceptibility Program, then the mesoscale landslide programs, and then the site specific landslide programs. This is an example of the landslide hazard zonation mapping along the Bhalukpong to Bomdila section, where this has been classified into highly hazard zone, moderate, and very high zone, where they after studying all the landslides. And these are photographs of some landslides that occur along this road section. And based on this map, the district authorities can have their preparedness accordingly. And at the same time, GSI also suggests preventive measures as well as future course of action, what to be taken up if a landslide happened in a particular area. That comes with this, I come to the end of my presentation. I prepared this presentation very basic, keeping in mind students of NEHU. I never expected that so many participants will be participating. I hope this presentation has been useful to you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your admiring speech. Now the lecture series is open for discussion.
As such, we have got wide variety of participants, so your lecture is apt. So it is a good presentation, although there should be some question to be answered. Is there anybody wants to say something or comment or have any suggestion for him?
I have a question here. He's asking, what are the steps to follow to study and identify the active fault in the sub-Himalayan region? The first step will be, ma'am, I'll suggest is the mapping. Mapping is the first step. We will be identifying various features in the field. Then only after that we'll be able to take up preemptive measures. So going to field and identifying the these features like these, just what I have shown you, the dikes, and then we have stylolites, and these type of features we can map in the field area. That is the first step.
Yeah, so as such, this question is good. There are many geomorphic features. There are many features which needs to be identified in the field so that you can identify the active fault. Present. Even using some recent latest tools, you can identify some differentiation and then it can be taken up, madam. Is there anybody else wants to say or comment? Little ahead, as the time passes, some questions may come. Would you like to say something, comment upon thick-skinned or thin-skinned tectonic or thrusting or tectonism in this region?
I think I'll not be in a very good condition to comment on that. If you can add from your answer, I'll be very thankful, sir.
Yeah, because one person has asked otherwise in the group. So it's all right. It may take a little longer time. So for the time being, we'll not go into the lot of discussion, but let us have Meghali, we can have our third presentation.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Although before you start calling, dear friends, this is one of the most fascinating areas which is being discussed, which is being presented. And it has got lot of variety of structures, variety of rock types. It has got economic mineral potential. We already know that it has got the potential to even to give hazards, which may become disaster. So the region, this northeastern region, is very, very important for all of us to understand. And so that we should be able to contribute a little bit more during this 75 years, taking lessons from Geological Survey of India and taking it forward because this region is not that much studied. This region needs more focus. So I'm very happy that so many people established in their life, as well as to upcoming budding scientists, they have participated. Probably they will take lead and take carry out some good work, not only in Arunachal Pradesh, but other parts of this terrain also. We know that this is a very difficult terrain, which is still needs to be worked out. So with your enthusiasm, with your zeal, with your energy, probably something good will come out in the times to come. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, Meghali, you can take up.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now I would like to request Dr. Debahuti Mukherjee, Superintending Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeastern Region, for delivering the lecture on the distribution of the fossils in various rock types representing the age range and paleo environment of deposition and paleo current directions. Over to Ma'am Mukherjee, please.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. It is really very, very much of a privilege to be amongst all the people, the NEHU and GSI, and to be able to speak on this occasion. And respected Dr. Rajeshwar, HODNER, Professor Lamin, PVC NEHU, and Professor Devesh Walia, HOD Department of Geology. It's really an honor to be able to speak in this. So my topic now, so we'll be just shifting a bit from the hard rock and the tectonics to a bit on the softer part. And as the topic we have discussed is, how do we interpret fossils and its uses in to understand the depositional age and the environment. So I have structured the talk in a way that we would just be briefly seeing that, why should we study the fossils and get a brief on the paleontological studies in GSI. And then we just have a look on how do we comment on age, basically. From fossils, are we really able to get the absolute age or the relative age? And what are the different logic by which we are deriving into such conclusion? And then the paleo environmental studies. And after that, we'll just be briefly seeing with some case study outlines. So yes, if I just say that fossils is like a biological black box. And I mean, apart from the lot of interpretations that we can do about fossils, here we are, in fact, focusing on environment and stratigraphy because of the age factor. So now, I think in the beginning, one thing should be very much clear that during fossilization, actually what's happening, it is the material from the biosphere, because it's the fossil is actually a living organism, a living animal. And so from the biosphere, the material is getting transferred to the lithosphere. And in this, there is a lot of processes involved. So when we are talking about anything, whatever we are inferring from the fossils, until and unless we are taking into account of the different processes which are involved, and which will be the geological fieldwork that will, in fact, reveal from that particular area, we won't be able to go to the age directly or the environment directly. So significance of fossils we can derive information is we can see the diversity, analyze the faunal pattern, we see the faunal dynamics. We can correlate, yes, and stratigraphy and relative age is in fact, the derivative of this stratigraphic correlation, and obviously the paleoenvironmental and the paleobiogeographic interpretation. So in Geological Survey of India, the field season programs, actually paleontology is under the Mission 4C, which is a fundamental geoscience. In fact, that is what which is in fact dealing with the paleontology and the petrology research items. And now, I mean, being in Geological Survey of India has the greatest thing for a researcher is that you are seeing, you can see whatever region you want. There are different regions. And naturally, that means different tectonic domains and different geological interval. So basically, the way the research problem is being envisaged is dependent on that, that which tectonic domain or which geological interval we want to study, and obviously in which region that particular research project is being taken up. So if we just have a look in the paleontological research that has was being done in GSI, there was the, because you know, the GSI is a 170-year-old organization where we had a preliminary stage and where it was documenting and describing the different fauna, flora, and which was basically the time when a lot of exploration was going on in different domains, and we find them in our archives. Like, we have wonderful repository of fossils. We have the Paleontologica Indica, which are the storehouse of information. And after that, in fact, from that information, it went to describing particular taxonomic groups. And what I had mentioned about the paleons, in fact, if you happen to visit our CHQ library, you have you can see that, or obviously all of them are there also in our portal. So that was a time when the different taxonomic groups were being described. And naturally, once it is being described from India, so it was not just Indian, but at that time it was in fact, the later part of the 19th century or the early part of the 20th century. So we were also looking at things which were there in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, and naturally the correlation part, the stratigraphic correlation was also very much coming into the picture when the taxonomic studies were going on. After that, it was the stratigraphy, where biostratigraphy and the relative age that becomes, was the focus of the research programs, which was being taken up by GSI. And then for the last 20 years, in fact, our focus has been more on reconstructing the paleoenvironment, the paleobiogeographic problems, seeing the different tectonic domains, and obviously revisiting the taxonomic groups which were there in the previous years. Now, revisiting a particular taxonomic group does not always mean that it is a taxonomic study or the systematic study only, though it is very much important for evolution. But even if we comment, if we have to take a biostratigraphic work or paleoenvironment work, it is very important that we have the basic clear. And what is the base? The base is, in fact, the taxonomy, the systematics. Because until and unless you know the fossil assemblage that you are working upon, and also you have a good knowledge of the geology of the area, and which is with the lithostratigraphy, as well as with also having an idea about the tectonic domain in that particular area is in, we will really not be able to derive the conclusion. So as time passes and as we are having research in different domains, so naturally the research problems also emerges. So basically our focus comes from there. So when we will just have a brushing up of the different, you know, the basics. But in biostratigraphy, actually, what is the aim? It is to establish correlations between time equivalent strata by presence of some particular fossil species. Now, as such, it's a very straightforward approach that if you have some certain fossil species are present, then we say, and in two different geographic localities which are far apart, we might say that they are correlatable. But in the actual scenario, things are not so straightforward, because there are a lot of pictures that comes into playing, and that is again a case-specific problem. So, apart from that, what we would infer age or to establish correlation, which is of paramount importance, is the index fossils. I think we all know about that. And so there are some criteria that is also known, that it will have a widespread. It will show some rapid evolution because it has to have some characters by which it should be identified very, very easily, because it's not only the paleontologist, it is for the stratigraphers, for the mappers, who should also be able to understand that, okay, this fossil is present, and therefore my this would be the stratigraphic unit. So in fact, these are in fact the characters by which we will the index fossils are designated. So we all know that in fact in foraminifers, we have index fossils as are in Meghalaya, so naturally the Cretaceous Paleogene boundary will that always comes into the discussion. And how did this Cretaceous Paleogene boundary got established? You know that there has been there was a spike, and in fact it was the PRL from in the late 80s, I think, and then JSI, which took a lot of projects, by which we know about the iridium or the platinum group of elements that, the excursions. But this can happen in other mass extinction events too. It might also happen in lower level extinction events. In order to know that we are in the mass extinction boundary, that is the Cretaceous Paleogene boundary, it is in fact the index fossil, which is giving the particular age. So here I've just taken up, it's been a lot of publications, which has been taken up by GSI for a number of years, field season program. And in fact, so here what we know that this is zonal index, okay, the foraminifer, the typical foraminifer, which has been recorded in that interval, that is basically giving the Maastrichtian and the Danian, that line, in fact, an imaginary line, obviously, which can say for certain that yes, the KBG mass extinction event is located in Theriakat. Otherwise, there is no way. Like, we can say that the iridium anomaly layer might be just below or might be just up. It's not necessary that it will just coincide with the biotic turnover also. I mean, if you see other global examples, you will see the examples of that. So in order to go in for this kind of studies, in brief, what do we have to do? We have to go for a very extensive field work, because the lithostratigraphy
I think there is some problem.
Yeah, ma'am got disconnected.
Got disconnected. Even she is not in the room. So there must be some problem with the connectivity there. So, Meghali, you can, should we move on? Because it will take 2-3 minutes at least. So should we move on? You can invite so that I'll, although she is towards the end of her presentation. Just wait for a minute, otherwise we'll start the
valedictory. We'll switch over to valedictory session, okay, sir?
Yeah, just wait for 30 seconds. Let me try one call.
Once again. So we'll start the presentation now.
Achha, you are there. Okay.
Yes.
sometimes this connectivity issues are there. Although I'm very happy to notice that since beginning we have 150 plus participants, which is indicative of the nice presentations. So thank you, Shri J.K. Nayakji, for helping us organizing or promoting us, you know, organizing such a nice program. I can see some of the stalwarts working in the field of geoscience and taking forward the basic aim or the basic requirement of the geoscience, like Shri Uday Pratap Singh ji from Chhattisgarh. I don't know where his photo has gone. And I could see many of the people, those who are involved in various activities. We know, dear friends, that geology, whatever India's economy or economy of any country is there, it is dependent upon the raw material. And such raw material can only be provided through systematic geological studies, and in which Geological Survey of India is doing great job. And because of that only, now whatever status stage we have reached to a level where India can withstand the processes and even have a sustainable development. I can see Shri Uday Pratap Singh ji. He is the general manager in the steel and mining industry. I would like to request him, till Madam joins, to say a few words for promoting the geological studies, especially in this region of India. Mr. UP Singh ji, please.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Professor Walia. Since beginning, I am listening all these deliberations being carried out through this webinar, and I am pleased to see all these documents and figures for the first time. I have seen this geological formations of Northeast region, and I am very thankful for this team of GSI who has presented such a nice deliberation regarding geological formations of Northeast India.
Please go ahead.
Yes, so I'm sorry for the disturbance. So
madam, just wait for 1 minute. 1 minute, let him finish. Please.
Okay, thank you, Professor Walia. So I was just listening, and I was surprised to see that so many minerals are occurring in Northeast regions, and there is a very good opportunity for entrepreneurs or private entrepreneurs to come and do the investment in the region. And as we know, the basic development of the state come from the mines or mineral based industries. So it is very good opportunity I can see through this webinar. And one of the most important thing I would like to add upon here is now Government of India, Ministry of Mine has come up with a new MMDR Act. So many things and so many rules and regulations has been amended, and there is a lot of changes are there. All the mineral commodities now has to be allocated through the auction route only. There is no other route of allocation of the mineral resources. So I would suggest my friends in GSI, since they are exploring a lot of areas, so now they have to focus on developing the areas in a, you can say, auctionable blocks. Because until unless they explore the block up to the level of G3 or G2 level of exploration, these blocks cannot be auctioned and they cannot be come up for the commercial minings. So just going for investigation and reporting the minerals is not now a days for this investment. Now state government or GSI, they have to explore the blocks up to the level of G3 or G2. so that their exploration work can be come into the commercialized form and auctions can be done. So thank you very much, Professor, for giving me this opportunity to interact with such a large forum and a lot of people. I would like to thank all of you for joining this webinar, and it's very great success. Thanks, Professor.
Thank you, Shri UP Singh ji. Dear friends, dear participants, we are very lucky to have him in this webinar. And we, you people, you are really lucky to have shared some of the very, very important aspects of taking it forward. We know that geology as a subject, but geology finally leads to development of a nation. As we are thinking of developing a nation, we need to be much more precise, much more say workable deposits, so that they can be used for development of the society and the people. So thank you, UP Singh ji, once again. Madam, let us come back to the to the lecture, please. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, first of all. So I will just continue. So,
madam,
yes.
Yes. Madam, just I will just briefly I will respond to Sri UP Singh ji. I take this opportunity and a pride that to tell to respond in this manner that GSI is taking up exploration very extensively in Arunachal Pradesh, and as of now, currently we are taking up at least 10 to 15 G2 and G3 exploration blocks, and certainly in near future we will be.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you. So actually, nowadays this is the demand of this time, you can say. And so yes, we'll until unless we explore the block up to the G2, G3 level, they cannot be come into the mining actually.
Yes.
Because
thank you.
Everything
both of you for this pertinent and very important information.
In very large extent. With this, I thank you, Professor Walia, for giving me opportunity to interrupt rather. Yeah.
And such information is for the participants, because more such industries take up or come up, there is a more job prospect for you all. So we look forward to such a nice interaction between the geoscientist and the geo industrialist to have interacted on this forum. So we are very thankful to both of them. Please, madam, you can continue now.
Thank you. So I will just continue what I was indicating. In fact, we were discussing was on the stratigraphic aspect, that why the fossils and the stratigraphic and the age is also very important. In fact, if we want to go for other studies also, when we are seeing the particular tectonic domain, so naturally, in geologists of GSI, we are also doing the stratigraphic work. And so here comes, if it's a fossiliferous interval, so naturally the fossils are of utmost importance. So like index fossil, but it is not necessary that everywhere we will get the zonal index. So at that time, the faunal assemblage plays a role, and we in fact go for the relative age determination from that. So, okay, so as the topic is on the depositional environment of fossils, so we know that environment is having numerous implications in geological studies. And we, as I, in fact, in the first slide, that the fossilization process is very important, and where, which in fact is a resultant of the different kind of the depositional, factors which is involved as the biological organism is becoming a fossil. And so knowing about that, in fact, has a role when we are doing the paleoenvironmental interpretation. So apart from providing the time frame, the information on evolution of life and plant fossils are also there in the past environment. And in fact, when we are reconstructing the environment, there are certain problems. That is, in fact, the taphonomic aspect and also the paleoecology, which are, in fact, until and unless we are studying that, so the reconstruction of the environment is not possible. So as I was telling when I talked about the stratigraphy, that it is a very simple thing when we talk about stratigraphic correlation. But basically, when we are in the field, there are a lot of problems involved. So what is that? And that, in fact, there is a bias in the fossil record. Like there will be a size bias, abundance bias, or a preservation bias, in fact, because every organism is not having the same kind of potential of getting preserved. It depends on the shell. And now, why is this important? Because when, for example, if we have to target a particular kind of environment for, say, a particular kind of, aspect, maybe some kind of genesis that we are trying to go to. So there, I mean, we need to know the environment or the particular stratigraphic horizon, which will have that environment in a very finer manner. So in that cases, in those problems, it is very important that we take all the factors into account. Next, so another very important aspect is taphonomy, because taphonomy is actually distorting the biological record. So what we are concluding from the paleobiological aspect, until and unless we are seeing the taphonomic history properly, we might misinterpret. But again, for the paleoenvironmental study, taphonomy is in fact giving us some extra information, which is also a tool for paleoenvironmental reconstruction. Like, for example, we might have some kind of record by which we will recognize that it is a mixed assemblage. Once it is a mixed assemblage, we would like to know what are the factors which were responsible that the faunal assemblage is mixed. Like that means it is not the autoecology that we are looking at. So there has been some postmortem transport. There might have been some mixing, some time averaging, or environmental condensation. So all this, I'm not going into the detail of all these things, but just would like to mention that these are the points which one has to look into when we are solving such kind of research problem. So here, just as an example, I have two photographs. One is a shell concentration and one is a Rinconellite colony. And I hope you are able to make out the difference. When I am talking about concentration, that means that it is the sedimentary, the diagenetic processes involved that have made this concentration. But when I'm talking about the Rinconellite colony, that means this is also the place where the biota was there. There has not been a lot of post-mortem transport. So there are factors by which we can say that it is a colony or it is a concentration. So these are, in fact, the examples when we talk about a mixed assemblage, or we are talking about an assemblage which has, in fact, which will give us some information about the autoecology. So, from the different if you can just list from the different parameters, like we are using fossils to determine different environmental aspects, various aspects of paleo, of climate, of the water depth, the bathymetry, the water energy, sediment type, and finally the basinal configuration. Then there are it's the organism, the morphology of the organism that can be interpreted to also comment on if the environment was a turbulent environment or a stable environment, if it was a shallow sea or a deeper environment. So these are also very important points. And then again, if we are having broken or disarticulated shells, so this is also pointing to some, typical conditions, which we are always noting down. So, and next is the paleobiological perspective, which is also very important, that we are getting from the morphology of fossils. So here, these are examples, like different kind of organism, they have different kind of ecological niches. So depending on that, when you are seeing the assemblage, you are able to interpret of the water depth, of the temperature, of many other things also. And here it is a paleoecological part where, if we are getting, as I was telling, that if it's when I'm seeing the faunal assemblage, if we are getting, representative from the different groups, then we know that it is an autochthonous deposit. So from this, from the basic part, we just move on to what would be a basic methodology for studying a fossil assemblage. We will be having samples and population. We have to group them tentatively. We go for the biostratigraphy. We do some taxonomic descriptive study for by which we can go for the paleoecological interpretation. And finally, if we are having that kind of a assemblage, then we can also go for some statistical analysis. So for the diversity analysis, we have to the way we are sampling it, that's very important. What statistics we'll be using depends on our research problem. Okay, so with this backdrop, I shift on to some case studies, which can throw light on the different aspects that, in fact, I was discussing just before. So here, in Arunachal Himalaya, I think we all know that we have the Permian. And in fact, Permian, the lower Permian is very well, established. It's for GSI, in fact, it's a work of almost 100 years, probably, or a little less than that, when we are, having the records and the reports of different kind of fossils. And it is in fact the transgression from, in fact, the peninsular India or not. So the way the fossils are, their mode of occurrence, kind of taxonomy, so, and obviously the environment. So there are lots of literature. In fact, you can see on that, which is there, in fact, from the middle of the 20th century. But point out to one particular problem, that apart from the lower Permian, there were reports of a particular, horizon, which is a very fossiliferous, which had reports of fossils, but their affinity was, in some reports, it has been, only one report was there where it has been described as the upper Permian. Now, apart from Arunachal, Permian interval is also having a very global significance, because just like the Cretaceous Tertiary mass extinction event, we also have the biggest, in fact, of the mass extinction, that is the Permian Triassic mass extinction event. So getting any unit which is of the upper Permian has also implications from this point of view. So, but this unit, which was known as the, which was in fact deciphered as lower upper Permian, was in the successive studies, there have been studies which is refuting that. So basically our work was to in fact find out that is there any upper Permian in the Arunachal Himalaya. Now, we all know that Upper Permian is there in Kashmir, in Spiti, and in Zanskar Himalaya, in fact. So and you also know that during the Permian, the tectonics of of this area, of this region, was very much different. So so these were, in fact, to analyze the biogeography of the fossils. This was also one of our objectives, which obviously I'll not be dealing over here. Here, what I would just like to focus is the difference between the mode of occurrence of the lower Permian and the upper Permian. The lower Permian, in fact, is represented by the Bichon Formation. And if we see the fossiliferous units, we will find, abundance of fossils which will have brachiopods, bivalves, bryozoans, crinoids, even conulurids, even floral remains are there, of vertebrata, which we have found. So this kind of an assemblage, in fact, points towards a normal marine autoecology, because there are different groups, different animal groups which are there. And this is, in fact, a kind of a near coastal marine habitat. There are soft substrate dwellers, some suspension dwellers like brachiopods. From the bryozoa, we can interpret that they were shallow. We know that it is somewhat the warm temperature environment. And there are some brachiopod taxa, in fact, that also say about some stressed environment. But basically, brachiopods are shallow sea dwellers. So naturally, Is anybody saying something?
Please go ahead. Some disturbance was
continue, ma'am.
Okay. So, this kind of a faunal assemblage is present. So, now we know that in the during the Lower Permian, there has been a glacial phase, and this glacial phase is not only affecting the Gondwanas. Even if we, see the Siberian block specifically in the Lower Permian, we will see that the low brachiopods, which are in fact characteristic of those kind of terrains, are also mostly the cold water taxa. But with this, we are also getting in Arunachal, the cold balls, this vertebraria, the record of the vertebraria is there. So basically, you are having an environment which is giving you some cold water fauna, as well as some, traces by which you can understand that there has been a warming of the environment that was taking place. And once we correlate with other tectonic domains, we have been able to say that this is in fact the retreating part of the glacial phase. And during that phase, in fact, in particular areas, warming event also it takes place. So that's also a characteristic of that. And also particular foraminifer, it's a Fusulinid genus, Irlandia, have been recorded, which is again a warm water fauna. So this was about, how, if you are seeing the total environment, total fauna, how you can interpret about the environment. And for the age, in fact, though there is no particular taxa, which will definitely say that, it is of Sakmarian. So what we did was we made a database and we calculated the geological age from different international database, paleobiology database, which is available. And we made a percentage study. So where we have the 32% of them are found only from Sakmarian, by which we can say that, yes, it is probably the Lower Permian is definitely of the Sakmarian age. I was talking also about another unit, which is near Mariang in Kyong, it's a place called Dalguing, where the the fossiliferous unit is totally different from what we are seeing where we are seeing the Lower Permian. It is not only from the faunal assemblage point of view, but also the deformation. The fossiliferous unit, talks about, if you are doing the field, you get evidence of multiple deformation events, because the fossils, they're not present as body fossils, but like brachiopods, bivalves, you will find them aligned to the cystocity planes. So that means what I'm not going into the detail of this work, but point is that in the same Arunachal Pradesh, the Lower Permian and in the Upper Permian, we already find that there is so-called Upper Permian, that there has been a so-called difference in the deformation history, deformation episode. So this is pointing towards a difference in time interval when we are seeing of the Permian, because though some of the faunal element is common, but here we are focusing more on the tectonic elements in by which we are, and also the stratigraphy by which we are coming into the conclusion regarding the age. So this is another example where it's about the environment. Like we are having a coral, it's a very famous, global section stratotype of the Calovian, the coral bed, which is, the environmental study of that is, interpreting, is way of like, there are a lot of aspects that can be studied. One can study the faunal assemblage, one can see the what kind of the zonal index are present over there. Like, for example, ammonites are present, we have some brachiopod assemblage zone by which we can correlate with other biogeographic provinces. And then, from the faunal assemblage, we can come to the conclusion about the particular temperature, which is around a tropical kind of, sea, which was in fact prevalent during that particular Jurassic interval. After that, now, because stable isotopic studies are also very common, so the stable isotopes of some particular fossils, which where the diagenetic alteration is not there and which are very good for paleoclimate indicators, that has been carried out, by which we, in fact, that has, also strengthened the temperature, and now it has been calculated at around 25 to 26 degrees centigrade. So here, what I am trying to focus on, that from the faunal assemblage, we are deriving some conclusion, and then with again, some geochemical studies, we are getting some more information about the environment from which we are having a lot of other interpretations too. So I will just briefly focus on our Meghalaya shelf also, because we are in Meghalaya. Here we know that apart from the mass extinction event, which is a foraminiferal turnover, there are also a lot of invertebrates which are there during this mass extinction time. And from the diversity studies of that, from the taxonomic diversity, from their size diversity, one can again come into the conclusion regarding the age. Regarding the age and also regarding the specifically for the paleo environment, and if there has been any environmental stress, because we are dealing with interval which is just near the mass extinction boundary, so understanding the environment is far more interesting, because everybody would like to find out that if there were some precursor of the mass extinction event which were there. And so there are a few, the inferences from the faunal assemblage pattern, from the diversity pattern, by which we have come into the conclusion that probably there were toxicity in the marine environment. That means the sea, the shallow sea, was already getting toxic, and that had affected the fossil biota, the biota which was present. And in fact, that is reflected in the fossils that we are studying. So this is one example, how by understanding the environment, we can also comment, or we can also do some more fine tuning of the environmental perturbations that is there when there are extinction events. And so we have also done some paleoclimatic studies, because what was the temperature of deposition was very important. And so this is the first time that we got some stable isotope data from the fossils. And it is also, it just points to a shallow sea temperature. And another environmental problem is that I think we all know that there are reports of dinosaur bones from the lower part of the Mahadeg formation. But in the upper part of the Mahadeg formation and also in the Langpar formation, which are all in the upper Cretaceous, we are having marine fossils, which are characteristic marine fossils. So the sauropod bones, which are in fact mainly continental, in fact, they were deposited, and the environment that they were in is of, sort of a marshy environment, fluvial environment. So getting the sauropod bones in particular places, and then getting typically marine fauna in other places. So how the environment in the basin has changed during that short interval of time, that is the mass extinction. So this is again another aspect which in fact we have been working on in the recent years, and we have come to the conclusion about the study. So with the dinosaur bones, we also have some very good wood fossils. So this is again also something which is, which we can say about some marshy areas or fluvial areas. And so the paleocurrent, which were measured from that places where the sauropod bones were recorded. This is again, though with the paleocurrent, we are not directly getting anything from the fossils, but basically it is telling us about the depth. In fact, we know that what could be, where is the deeper part and where is the shallower part. So this current direction with the paleocurrent direction and with the stratigraphic aspect, when we are combining together to reconstruct the paleo environment, becomes, we are having far more data. And in fact, in Meghalaya, we find that it's very interesting the way we are getting the deeper, in fact, deeper fauna towards the deeper part, so which we are in fact getting from the value currents. So with that, finally, if we see the paleo environment during the Cretaceous time, we see that there has been a changeover, like a fluvial environment that changed into a transitional and then to a typically marine environment. And after that, we have the Cretaceous Paleogene, in fact, the event which is there, where which in fact happened in basically a shallow sea. And so, as I just referred about the paleoclimatic studies, these are the till now what I was telling is all from field data, the fossils that we are finding from the field, and with that, the laboratory studies, we are interpreting about the environment. But also, we now have the with the mass spectrometry, we can go for paleoclimatic studies. And there are particular, again, it's very important which fossil group to choose. So when we are doing this kind of study, it's very important which fossil will give the most accurate data. So with that, it is possible that if we have calculations of the, you know, the isotope data and the paleo temperature, which can be calculated of a particular litho column, a stratigraphic interval, say this is about 12 to 15 million years of interval, which has been sampled. And then we can also interpret the excursions that have taken place in the isotopic ratio, and which is also the temperature excursions that have taken place, that again has affected the environment and naturally also the faunal assemblies which is present, because all of them are very much connected together. So this is in fact how it is done. I've just shown it briefly. So thank you very much. So that was all about my the talk that I was presenting.
Yeah, thank you, madam, for very elaborate presentation. Thank you very much. Yeah, Meghali, you can please go ahead. I hope she has gone. So, madam, thank you very much. If there is any quick one or two comments, yes, or questions, they are most welcome. If anybody wants to say something, although there have been some questions in the chat box, even in the YouTube, there are some questions, but it may take some time. So I think we should say thank you to madam.
Thank you,
otherwise, it will take a little longer time. So madam, yes, thank you very much for giving really very elaborate and very important information and research which you have shared. And we need to take it forward to a level that we come to some conclusive end, because geological studies needs to come to one level. If their economic potential is there, we need to work on. If otherwise, we need to locate some of the deposits, we need to know the paleo-environmental conditions and even the age. So thank you, madam, for this elaborate presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, now we switch over to valedictory session. I would like to request Professor Davis Walia, sir, head of the Department of Geology, Nehu, Shillong, for valedictory address. Sir, please.
Yeah, thank you, the organizers, for giving me this chance to talk with the very active participants, because we could see that around 120 of you are there online. So it is a great thing. Firstly, before moving on, I would like to request all those participants, those who can switch on your camera, just switch it on so that we can have one photograph which may be published or which may come in the tomorrow's news or something. So please switch on your camera before I move on so that we can have a photograph of yours and we can store this event, not only by way of recording it, but by way of clicking a photo, and for most of us, please do. And Meghali, you can change to the grid mode so that all the faces can be seen. Yeah, for short time, if you are there in isolation or in your room, You may remove your mask also so that the picture is normal. Most all of you are welcome to for the photograph. And it's just a request. If you think you are not in a safe location, keep wearing your mask on. That message is there in all the presentation. And that message is also there through us. So the organizers, please go on clicking the photograph. You can shift the focus. You can. All of you are requested, those who are there, please switch on your camera for short time only. If all of you switch on, then it will take less time. So otherwise, I'll keep on requesting. So all of you, if you switch on your camera, it will be good for us to click a photo. I can see that most of you have switched on, but the younger generation, as usual, is taking time. So if you think you don't want to switch on, it's okay. But better is if you switch on. I can see around 60-65 participants, they have switched on their camera. So the organizers can go on clicking. You can change the focus and go on clicking the photograph, please. Yeah, even participants, you also can keep clicking the pic and you can post it so that at least from your point of view also the photograph will be there. I think we have done the work. There are more than 50%, 60% of the people there on, but it is because normally what happens that your mobile may not have that much say data or and all. So the moment you may switch on, you may get disconnected also. So don't keep it on for very long. So I think organizers, would you like to say that now should we move on?
Yes, sir, you can continue, sir. We got enough pictures.
Yeah, now it is up to you whether you want to keep yourself, your video on or off. This is up to you. So, dear friends, after listening to very elaborate and very good, very exhaustive, very extensive lectures about the geology, about the economic mineral potential of the Eastern Himalayan zone, as well as about the structure and tectonics of the Eastern Himalayan and Eastern syntaxial Himalayan syntaxial zone, as well as the fossils for representing the age range and the paleoenvironmental deposition by the eminent geoscientist from Geological Survey of India, Dr. Theono, Mr. Leshram, Dr. Debahuti. I would like to tell you all that under this theme, wherein, as I said in the beginning, that the freedom of expression, the freedom of your thoughts is very, very important to take us forward. So in the process of these presentations, you might not have asked any query, but if there is any query, you are free to ask any time during any time of your life or little later through email or through any of the processes directly to the presenters or even through us wherever you feel comfortable, because we need to respect each and every idea. The idea is important, however big or small you think your idea may be. But the idea is very, very important, because without idea, we can't move forward. Even the geology has come up from a science of God or theology, or similarly physics or whatever subjects have come up from such ideas only. So the idea are very, very important, whatever you may think, small or big. The third thing is the action. If the idea is there, then only you will be able to take any action, and that action may be sustainable. That's what is very important. And if this freedom of expression, the ideas, the action are there, then only you'll be able to achieve the desirable things which you expect. Without that, you won't be able to achieve, and then only the issues may come up, you may be able to resolve, and you may be able to move forward. With these some important messages for Azadi Ka Mahotsav, I would like to tell you that Northeastern region has got great potential. Today we touched only three important aspects: structure and tectonics, lithology, and fossils. But the surface geology is a, one of the very, very challenging tasks, and it also poses challenge to the national as well as international geoscientists, and they always love to visit northeastern part of India because it is a working laboratory wherein you get all various types of faults, various types of faults, various generation of faults, various generation of faults, and their interaction. That's what is very, very important. Not only on the surface representation is there, but beneath the surface also such representations are there. So here in the northeastern part, not only the geological studies are important, but also the geophysical branch or also the remote sensing branch is of great importance, because this area is definitely remote. Although still the development is going on at a very fast pace, but to be at par with rest of the India, it may take some more time to be there. So for such achievements to take them forward, we need to integrate the remote sensing or the above the surface and the subsurface studies, so that we are able to put or to give the best possible alternatives to the younger generation or to the generations to come. Because we know that our generation, we don't owe the earth. Earth belongs to our future generations too. So we need to take steps so that not only the simple steps, but the concrete steps to take whole nation forward. I must appreciate at this point of time the work carried out by Geological Survey of India. Even before the independence, before our independence, it was there. But our independence, after the independence, their work is yeoman's work, and it has proved to be a great potential. As I already told you in the beginning, that the country's growth and achievement or the respect by the various countries is dependent upon its economy, and economy is totally dependent upon the mineral wealth or the natural resources which is present in the surface of the earth. But the important thing is, when we are thinking of developing the natural resources, then many myths, many of the wrong concepts, they come into the picture. So the important part through these programs is to fill up the gap between the myth and the actual thing. I'll tell you, dear friends, through this forum, that there are places, even in Africa, it is expected to be in the developed nation, even in Africa, where there is a zero waste or zero pollution mining is there. So the myth is that if you'll do mining, there will be a lot of destruction to the environment, destruction to the nature is there. Definitely, it will not be foolproof, but there are methods, there are practiced methods, there are known methods, there are scientific methods. If you use those methods, probably you can get the resources which are hidden beneath the surface, but they are of great importance. They may be of critical or strategic importance to the nation. So that's what is of great importance for us to understand. In the today's presentations, we have seen, we have taken up only Arunachal Pradesh, and our focus was on Arunachal Pradesh. But I'll tell you that, dear friends, that this Arunachal Pradesh, which is definitely much more remote as compared to the some of the states of northeastern part, and has got excellent preserved rocks, structures, and even they have got very good economic mineral deposits, which can be worked out, which can be explored, which can be exploited or for the national benefit, national use. So as during the presentation, economic mineral presentation, we know that tin, tungsten, even platinite, platinum group of minerals, so many important minerals are present in this part of the India. Even we know that there is chromium, there is nickel, there is lead, zinc. There are so many things. In the Subansiri, he presented that there is a presence of gold is also there. And once we understand the structural features or the tectonics of the region, very easily we can locate some of the economic mineral potentials. We know that this is the region where during the British time, they could see the oozing out of the oil onto the surface of the earth. So you can understand that this region has got excellent potential. But only thing is the gap between the myths for mining and the mineral potential needs to be filled up. So this whole potential lies on your shoulder. Those who are budding geoscientists or upcoming geoscientists or whatever field you belong to and you are attending this program, the responsibility lies on you to see to it that our nation develops and develop to a level that the people may say that yes, that's what is expected out of it, and it can only be done jointly. So your all participation is a must. I'll not take time, too much time, because you all are there since 2, and already we are about to have around 4:15. But I would like to know from the organizers, are your certificates and the system of the certificates is ready so that we can move ahead and we can do away.
Yes, sir. I want to announce that with the permission of head of the Department of Geology, Nehu Silong, we would like to release the certificate for all the participants who have registered for today's lecture series shortly.
Yeah. So I would like to request Shri J.K. Nayak ji also, and if Dr. Rajeshwar ji is there, I would like to see both of them, and would like to. I know that our Professor Lemon is also attached. He is attending the meeting. He called me sometime back that he is attending. Just let me check whether he is there, still there. Yeah, sir is also there. Professor Lemon is also there. Even our Vice Chancellor sir also called. He is there somewhere in Delhi or Lucknow. He also said that he attended the meeting and he is there. So all those who are there, they can switch on their video so that all other participants they'll be able to see you. And with your once your camera is on, then we can release the certificate. The system is that all of you, once you have filled in the Google form, which is enclosed here, and given your name correctly and your email correctly, then within 10 minutes, you all will be getting your certificate. So you can just check that all this data is correct. So I think all other, say our Vice Chancellor, Pro Vice Chancellor, sir, they are still in a mobile mode. So right now he is not switching on his camera. So because he had meeting for establishment of academy for legal studies. So they went for meeting at Guwahati High Court, which was the meeting was being chaired by the Chief Justice Chief Justice of Shillong High Court. So maybe he is still there in the meeting, but sometime back he sent that I am attending the program. So, dear friends, you all can see all the people behind organizing this program successfully. I would like to thank DDG, HOD, GSI, NER, Dr. J. Rajeshwar ji for taking out time and inspiring us by your presence and to have taken us to this whole journey of celebration of our independence struggle, or you can say that 75 years of independence, as you also told, as our Pro Vice Chancellor and Vice Chancellor also said, that we'll be organizing some series of program wherein all of you are expected, you are requested to join in. I would also like to say to Jayant Kumar Nayak ji that such program, although we were planning and planning, but it is very difficult to finally organize. So he is the main force behind organizing this program. So before moving on for the formal vote of thanks, I would like to thank on my behalf to Shri Jain Kumar Nayak ji to have forced us to organize this program, and definitely all the participants to have come up. Towards before ending my valedictory speech, I would like to say that your participation, active participation, is required, dear participants and all the dignitaries present here, to take the journey of geological study forward. We know that the journey of geology is very, very long with respect to the time, billions of years. But your contribution of 50 years or 100 years also is going to add up into such journey. So I would like to thank you all. Thank all the organizers to have given chance for this interaction. Thank you.
Now it's time for Dr. Sikhar Kumar to offer a vote of thanks.
Madam.
Oh, yes.
Hello, madam.
Yes,
madam, this is Chicken Nike.
Yes.
Can I add,
please?
Put so before going for the formal vote of thanks, I would like to thank Professor Walia. Initially, we thought of sharing our knowledge with the students of NEHU, Department of Geology. But it certainly, with his effort, he has taken it pan India, and it is very heartening. To see so many participants for this webinar. It is his efforts that he has converted it into such a beautiful platform. He has provided the geoscientists of GSI to showcase their or the present the experience we have with us. I'd like to thank my team of geoscientists who have taken pain for preparing the presentations and such succinctly. The vast topics of Himalayan geology has been presented during this webinar. You have very rightly said, Dr. Professor Walia, that this is the laboratory of geology. I will not be wrong if I say that this particular region, from northeastern region, it has all the geological from starting from the beginning of the earth to the latest stage, to the Meghalayan age. So this will definitely, I will try to enthuse the new budding geoscientists that this is the laboratory, as you said, and any particular domain you choose, and there is just space and scope of work in northeastern region. It will be our privilege as a part of GSI to interact with all of you, maybe from geo industries, or maybe with the universities, and anyone will be freely contact the GSI at hod.ner@gsi.gov.in through presence in each 8 states of NER. We will be able to cater to your inquisitiveness, and wherever possible, your needs will be definitely met with. And with this, I'll not take much time. I would like to thank Professor Lamin and our Dr. J. Rajeshwar, DDG and HOD to giving up this opportunity to celebrate the Bharat Ka Amrut Mahotsav, that is 75th year of commemoration of our independence. I thank you, and to inform that even geoscientists from GSI, from all the state units, 8 state units have joined this webinar, and I thank all of them. Thank you again. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Before our formal vote of thanks begin, I could see the formal Director General of Geological Survey of India. I don't know whether he has returned to India or he's still in US, but I would like to request him to say one or two lines to bless the people, those who have joined this important program. Nitish Kumar Datta, sir, please.
Hello, Devesh. So nice of you. I thought of joining at 2 o'clock, but just things are not so good here. So Okay, I know GSI. I had been to Northeastern region in 2009 or so, visited my office. I have not seen the sections in Northeast, but I remember distinctly the Barapani and Shillong group of rocks and all those things. And nice interaction with my colleagues then. My younger colleagues may not be knowing me now. It's about 12 years that I've retired. Debahuti, I know. Debahuti has done so good work. And Mohanta, Vashab Mohanta, I know. So many people, and I have lost a good friend, Ivan Shengyan or something like that. He is no more. He was in Arunachal when I was in GSI at Calcutta. Earlier to that, Devesh may be knowing that I am a Sagarian basically. I worked mostly in Bastar, then in Central Region. So I'm not much known to Northeast people. Very interesting, D.R. Nandi's memoir and all those things I have read lately. So, earlier P1s and all those things, they were our time. So, Northeast region has a great potential, as just now I heard from the academicians, that it requires a lot of fire. And with Tejpur, this seismicity and all those things, it requires a lot of attention, and the great Brahmaputra, our own river, so mighty it is. So I remember all those things, Devish. Thank you very much. I'm very much in India, among the COVID people.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you very
thank
much.
You, thank you so much for giving
for your time and for everything. If anybody else, because we are basically converting 75 years of Indian independence in. If anybody else wants to say one or two line, then you are welcome. Otherwise, we'll have formal vote of thanks. You need to unmute and speak. Or you can raise your hand, then we can unmute you. Yeah, I think it is okay. Anybody? Yeah, it's all right. So basically, we are celebrating Amrit. So that's what it took around 75 years to churn, and we have reached to a level. So now I would like to request the organizers to please propose vote of thanks, formal vote of thanks. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So good afternoon to everyone. Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, Northeastern Hill University, Professor H. Lemin, sir. Respected DDG and HOD, Geological Survey of India, Northeast Region, Dr. J. Rajeshwar, sir. Respected Director, PSS, Geological Survey of India, Northeast Region, Sri J. K. Nayak, sir. Respected HOD, Department of Geology, Northeastern Hill University, Professor Devesh Walia, sir. Our most valued invited lecturers and guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion on behalf of the organizing committee. I, on behalf of Department of Geology, Northeastern Hill University, and Geological Survey of India, Northeast Region, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all the speakers for taking out their time from their busy schedule and gracing us with their presence and sharing with us their opinions today. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Professor H. Lehman, sir. Inspiration from you, sir, is what guides us all to work harder and conduct such programs. A heartfelt thank you to Dr. J. Rajeshwar, sir, for his presence and his inaugural address on the momentum occasion. We are grateful to Professor Devesh Walia, sir, for successful organization of this program and his guidance extended to all of us. We are extremely grateful to our invited speakers, Dr. K.V. Thionio, Senior Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeast Region, Sri Ramesh Laishram, Senior Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeast Region, and Dr. Devabhuti Mukherjee, ma'am, Superintendent Geologist, Geological Survey of India, Northeast Region, for their very informative and captivating lectures. I am certain that all the participants here have learned something today. Last but not the least, I would like to express our sincere thanks to all the participants who have joined the program today. The feedback form you all have submitted will be evaluated, and we will make the necessary modifications while arranging any such similar programs in the future. If any of you have any problems in receiving the certificates, please feel free to communicate via email. Please do check your spam folders, as sometimes automatic emails are mistaken as spam by the email service. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, I would like to thank all the speakers who have taken out time for being with us today. It has been a great pleasure. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Shikhar. Thank you everyone for joining. Thank you very much. And we'll try to post through your email the PowerPoint presentations or PDF copy of the presentation for your knowledge or information. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Datta sir. Thank you, our Rajeshwar sir. Thank you very much.
Rajeshwar, good evening. Take care, all.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Walia. Datta sir, बहुत बहुत प्रणाम. बहुत अच्छा लगा आपको इतने दिनों के बाद देखने के बाद.
I was very desperate to see you and my GSI colleagues.
All right. We'll end the meeting now, sir. Thank you. Organizers, please take care.
Yeah, we'll meet again.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sure. Thank you.